This morning, as Paul was putting up the numbers for singing songs this morning, I asked him, did you find any songs for hand clapping? And he turned around and started, yes, I did. They're all in the name of the Lord. And that's about it. We could just say, well, it's not in the name of the Lord, so that's it, and just leave it at that and go home. Well, you know better than that. We do want to, though, look at what's wrong with hand clapping. From change agents, and they termed themselves that years back, have always sought change, and they've attacked the pure worship that was established by God in long ago. They tried to change it and alter it, along with other things, but the primary focus has been on the worship that God has instituted. And we have seen this in reality from the very beginning of time. When Cain went to make offerings to God, God was not pleased with it. Cain did not offer his offering by faith. And thus, Cain was upset, but God didn't accept his offering because he changed, he altered something in regards to it. So it's something that has always been seen. If we could spend the time this evening, we could just go through the entirety of the Old Testament, and we could see a continual change being made of the worship that God has instituted. But changes that man make in the worship that God has authorized obviously do not find, if they're changes from what God has stated, they're not something that find their origin in God, but they are finding their origin in man. And finding their origin in man, then, that makes the worship vain. Jesus said in Matthew 15, verse 9, that in vain do they worship me, teaching for doctrine the commandments of men. They should have been teaching for doctrine the commandments of God. But they had discounted what God said, and they had elevated their traditions above what God said, and thus Jesus is saying their worship is vain, it's worthless, it has no value. And so as we look at hand clapping, the origin of hand clapping comes as far as from a religious standpoint to a great extent from the Pentecostal movement. And the emotional aspect of Pentecostalism, they would, because of that emotionalism, jump up and down and clap their hands and all of this other thing. It was pure emotionalism that was setting forth within Pentecostalism. But also, we could say from the entertainment aspect, we have been, as a people, conditioned to be entertained. We have seen this, especially with the movies and television. Television brought it down to even a greater individual nature. The movies, still in the way in which they are produced and the way in which they are shown, the big screen that they have, we sit back and we are just entertained. But it's a sophisticated art form. That's why they spend literally millions and millions of dollars on both movies and television. Because they can get this down to a science. And man, all he has to do is just sit there and take it all in. It holds our attention without really no effort on our part. We don't have to do anything except sit there and watch. We don't have to think. We don't have to act. We don't have to respond. We are just being entertained. are some who defend hand clapping in worship, though. And some will even say that hand clapping is authorized in the Old Testament. In Psalm 47, in verse 1, the scriptures state, "Oh, clap your hands, all ye people. Shout unto God with the voice of triumph." So here's the admonition that in praise to God for there to be the clapping of hands. Also, many would point out 2 Kings 11 and verse 12, where it says that he brought forth the king's son and put the crown, put the crown upon him and gave him the testimony, and they made him king and anointed him. And they clapped their hands and said, "God save the king." So here, at the anointing of this one to be king, there was the clapping of hands that was associated with that, anointing that individual to be king. So they say, see, there it is in the Old Testament, and thus we have authority for it today. It's authorized, and we shouldn't frown on those individuals who want to praise God, even as specifically there in 47th Psalm in verse 1, who want to praise God by clapping their hands. What if the clapping of hands is authorized by passages such as these? Then in reality, everything else in the Old Testament is also. If you want to take one part of it, you're going to have to take all of it. You can't just say, kind of pick and choose, well, I'm going to pick this because I want to do it, but I'm going to exclude that because I don't want to do it. And so if you're going to say clapping is authorized because the Old Testament authorizes it, well, so are the animal sacrifices. And we're going to have to accept the animal sacrifices. Why? Because obviously they've been authorized in the Old Testament. So has polygamy. There were several very great men and faithful to God who were polygamists. So should we accept polygamy today as a result of that? Because they had it in the Old Testament. God didn't, they were not condemned by God as a result of it. So all of you women need to be quiet if your husbands decide to take another wife. Or three, or four, or five, or however many they want. If not, why not? Or instrumental music. And we'll get to that way a little bit later on. Won't deal too much with that. But all of the other things that we would see in the Old Testament, if clapping is authorized because the Old Testament sets it forth, and it's authorized during that period of time, then we have to take everything else that the Old Testament is involved in, and everything else that is authorized by the Old Testament. Others will defend hand clapping as saying, well, there's really no difference in hand clapping and saying amen. While I don't want to deal a great deal with this aspect or this defense of hand clapping too much at this time, because I'll come back to this aspect a little bit later on. Amen means so be it. It is getting approval and agreement to what is being said. On the other hand, the clapping of hands is to show approval of a person's performance. As I say, we'll come back to this a little bit later on in the lesson and develop it a little bit more and establish these points. But basically, you start seeing the difference between, because there is a difference between saying amen and the clapping of hands. There is a difference between the two. Others would say, well, it's just a natural reaction to the joy that we experience in worship. There might be a truth to the idea that someone claps their hands on a spontaneous action because of joy. That they are just so overjoyed that they, oh, How many times have we done something along that line? Just a natural, spontaneous reaction of joy. But there's a far different aspect in the clapping of hands like that, in a spontaneous reaction, and clapping in relationship to applauding or applauding. While one might be, yes, that spontaneous throwing of hands together one time because of that natural joy that, or sometimes maybe even surprise or some other reason, that's not the same as the clapping of hands that we're talking about or the applauding that we're talking about. Far different categories and aspects that we need to recognize the distinction between them. Then hand clapping in accompaniment to singing. God has authorized one specific type of music, that is singing. In 1 Corinthians 14 and verse 15, Paul would write, "What is it then? I will pray with the Spirit, and I will pray with the understanding also. I will sing with the Spirit, and I will sing with the understanding also." We pointed out at times past that the idea of Spirit here deals with my attitude. That I'm going to concentrate, I'm going to have a proper attitude in both my praying and my spirit. I'm going to think about what is being said, the contents. Understanding within the context of 1 Corinthians 14 is the giving of understanding to others. It's what we will see of teaching and admonishing one another. That aspect in relationship to that singing or that praying. But it is singing. I will sing with that spirit and with that understanding. Then in Ephesians 5 and verse 19, speaking to yourselves in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord. There again we see it is a singing. But that singing is a speaking to yourselves, a speaking. It is the use of words. And we'll come back to this aspect of it. But it is that saying of words. And the word speaking there is a Greek word which deals with the way in which those words are pronounced. Or we might say the enunciation or pronunciation of words. It's not dealing so much with the meaning of the words and giving understanding to others, but it is the actual pronouncing those words, speaking to yourselves. That's reciprocal action. We'll do it one to another. It's singing and making melody in your heart. That's the heart, that which is 1 Corinthians 14, verse 15, described by the Spirit, singing with the Spirit. Well, that's singing, making melody in your heart to the Lord. In Colossians 5, or 3 and verse 16, Paul would write, "Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord." Here's the teaching and admonishing one another. Here you're dealing with that understanding of 1 Corinthians 14, 15. That I will sing with the understanding. I'm singing in relationship to teaching other individuals and instructing them. One another, again, deals with that reciprocal action, that we're doing it at the same time, that you would be teaching and admonishing me while I'm teaching and admonishing you. It's done at the same time, one to another. And then uses those three classifications of religious songs, psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs, and then again, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. The "with grace in your hearts to the Lord" would be the same or equivalent to that which we find in Ephesians 5:19, making melody in your heart to the Lord, or what we would see in 1 Corinthians 14 and verse 15, "I will sing with the understanding," or with the Spirit. My spirit, grace in my heart, or in your hearts to the Lord. And so, but again, it is that aspect of singing. In James 5, in verse 13, is any among you afflicted? Let him pray. Is any merry? Let him sing psalms. And so here again, we have the singing of those here specifically mentioned psalms, but that would certainly include all that, those three categories of religious psalms. But it is a singing of those things. When we come to the aspect of music, though, there are two basic types of music. There is vocal music, or categories of music. There's vocal music, and there's non-vocal music. That's the only two categories or kinds of music that there exists. You cannot find any other kind of music, any other type of music. These are the two. When we look at vocal music, there are two categories of vocal music. One is a vocal music that communicates a message. And thus, on the chart here, communicable, that is, it is conveying a message. The other type or kind of vocal music is non-communicable. In other words, it does not convey a message to others. Now, when you're dealing with that which conveys a message to others, you're dealing with either you can do that within your foreign language or you can do it within your mother tongue. The tongue in which you're born with and of which you speak. You can communicate a lesson in either way. When you're dealing with that non-communicable, that does not convey a message, that would be the voice making sounds. But it does not deal with words. It does not convey a message. Humming does that. Whistling. Although it might not be with the voice, it's still human and does not communicate a message. There would be long sustained ohs or ahs, making our voices sound like instruments of music, and other sounds that we would make with our voice. But those sounds do not communicate a message. When we're dealing with singing, and I'll just add here, singing is a vocal music that communicates a message. That's the aspect of teaching and admonishing one another. It is communicating a message to others. That's what God has authorized. Now, if you look at any other type of music, any other kind of music, that means non-communicable. Or if we get over and we'll look at the aspect of non-vocal music in just a second, none of those other types or kinds of music are authorized by God. Only that vocal music that communicates a message. When we look at the non-vocal, and I realize that that's very small. I tried to get it to enlarge a little bit. And just there's too many different types of mechanical instrumental music that is non-vocal. And then there is non-mechanical instrumental music. That which would fall under the mechanical instrumental music, the categories would be divided up into the brass, which would be things like trumpet or trombone or tubas or things along that line. You have the woodwinds that would be the clarinets, the oboes, the flutes, and the other types of woodwind instruments. There's the percussion, which would be the drums, the timpani, the castanets, and other types of those that come under percussion category. There's the stringed instruments, such as the violin, the viola, the cello, a guitar would fall under that category. And then there's the category of electric synthesizers. That would be an electric piano or an organ or something along that line. All of those are mechanical humanly produced, and it is a mechanical, non-vocal, that is, it's something that has been made. It is by man in order to produce sounds or music. Then there is that second non-vocal category of non-mechanical instrumental music. And when you're dealing with non-mechanical instrumental music, or non-vocal in music, you would be dealing with and having that as sounds that are humanly, or the snapping of the sounds that are humanly produced, but not with the voice. The snapping of fingers, or stomping the feet, or if you know what hand boning is, hand boning. Also, clapping the hands falls under this category of music. It is a non-mechanical, instrumental, non-vocal music. God has not authorized that. God authorized one thing, and that is singing. Now then, let's look at hand clapping as applause. Because that's what we're really dealing with. These take place as far as the worship aspect at various times, and is practiced by various times by some today. Following sermons. After a sermon is given, or a lecture, then there is applause that is given for that individual. Then there's following baptisms. Someone is baptized, and so the congregation erupts into applause, clapping at the baptism. Sometimes there's other worship activities, but mainly those two. But then also at certain announcements, during the announcement period, while we recognize that's not actually our worship to God, it's connected with our worship, we make it announcements. And at some announcements that are made, people will again break out into applause. That's the areas that you see in relationship to hand clapping. But what is the purpose of applause? The New Oxford Dictionary defines applause as approval or praise expressed by clapping. When we turn over to clap, that same dictionary defines it as strike the palms of one's hands together repeatedly, typically in order to applaud. And then it goes on to say, show approval of a person or action in this way. And so the applause is to show approval, the clapping or striking the palms of one's hands together repeatedly, to show approval of a person or action. To approve or to praise by the clapping or the striking of the palms together. To look at the purpose of applause. It is to indicate personal approval. I approve of what they have done. I appreciate it. We applaud those who perform for us, and thus we are then indicating our approval of their performance, what they have done for us. And that's why we applaud. It gives us a way to show what we think of their performance. If they do a rotten performance, we might not applaud. We might just sit there and do nothing. If we think they did a great job, we're going to burst out in applause. Why? Because we're showing approval for the performance that they have done for us, that they have made for us. And thus, it gives us that opportunity to show appreciation for the performer. and his talent, his ability in that performance that in which he is given. A second or another reason for applause, purpose of it, would be as an expression of excitement. In this, we are personally moved by what is taking place. And as a result of that, the emotions and the expression of that emotion, we start applauding. In this, that expression of excitement, it becomes the emotional release or the outlet of our joy. We are releasing our joy. We have an outlet for our joy now by applauding that individual. And so it's that expression of excitement. And then there's another reason, and that is sometimes it's done simply to be courteous. This is often done on the political realm and oftentimes in academics, the academic realm. How many times have you seen politicians who politely will clap their hands, applaud, even though you know that they didn't approve, they didn't like what the other person said? But in order to be courteous and to show respect for that individual, they go ahead and applaud. What is it? Simply be courteous. It's a demonstration of etiquette, not agreement. They're not agreeing with the other politician. They're just being respectful. In the State of the Union address that will be done shortly, and we'll see the House and the Senate together as the President delivers his State of the Union speech. You will see at times individuals who will applaud what the President has said simply out of courtesy. When you know, because of everything that they have said, that they have absolutely no agreement with what the President has said. But because of that etiquette, it is required of them to applaud. When we get to worship, though, and you look at those purposes of applauding, none of those purposes are authorized actions of worship to God. It is not. You can't find it. But applause, by its very nature, draws attention to the performer. Now, the saying of amen, there's a distinction, and while some will say, why, applause is just another way of saying amen. Applause, by its nature, draws attention to the performer. Amen draws attention to the message, which is to, of course, exalt Christ. There's a vast difference between the performer and the message. Applause is for the performer. Amen is for the message. Saying amen is literally a God-authorized act. For example, in 1 Corinthians 14 and verse 16, he says, else when thou shalt bless with the Spirit, how shall he that occupieth the room of the unlearned say amen at thy giving of thanks, seeing he understandest not what thou sayest? You see, he places the emphasis on the message. Here's the saying of amen. But how can this person say amen if he does not understand what is being said? I could perform, or I could applaud a performer even though I have absolutely no understanding of what he said. We see that on a regular basis in the entertainment world. People go to an opera that is sung totally in a different language, a language which they have no concept of, And yet, they will enjoy the performance that is given, and they will applaud the performance. Do they understand what was said? No. Unless they study that opera, which they are going to listen to. They have no concept as to what has been actually said, but because of the appreciation of the performance, they applaud. Now then, amen, on the other hand, is saying, here's the message. This individual, if he doesn't understand the message, he cannot say amen. Amen draws attention to the message, not the performance. Applause draws attention to the performance, not the message. They're just exactly the opposite. Amen is used throughout both Testaments, both the Old Testament and the New Testament, and so, thus it is truly a God-authorized act, whereas applause or clapping of hands is not. Amen was used to convey agreement with the truth that was being stated, or the truth that was being affirmed. The truthfulness of God's Word. I may think, from a personal standpoint, that the way that truth might have been presented, the performance of that stated truth, might have been done in a rotten way. That doesn't affect the truthfulness of what is said, nor the ability or the right to say amen at that which was said, if it is in accordance with God's Word. There's the difference between these two aspects and these two actions. The saying of amen is a God-authorized act. Applauding is not. And thus that song that we sang now, before the lesson, do all in the name of the Lord. Well, that's absolutely correct. Colossians 3:17. Teaches us that everything whatsoever you do in word or deed, that's everything that we do, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God and the Father by Him. Everything that we do must be authorized by God. Where is the authority for in our worship to God? Applaud. It's simply not found within the Scriptures. And there's a reason for it. Applauding is not something that is a new invention of our society. It's just not. It's been around for a long, long time. It was around when they wrote the New Testament. Now, if applauding was appropriate, why didn't they say, go ahead and applaud? Why didn't they teach them to do that? The very purposes of applauding and saying amen shows why they did not teach them to applaud. Why it is not authorized. Because it draws attention to the performer and to the performance instead of the message. And we should always be concerned with the message, not the entertaining performance or the performer's talent that he might have and expressing appreciation for that talent. That's not worship. It is in the entertainment world and is to be needs to be confined to that world. Its emphasis, or amen, again, emphasizes the message rather than the person presenting the message. And its emphasis is to affirm the truthfulness of what is being stated. While there's a lot of individuals who will, and groups and even members of the church who will applaud at different aspects and different things, we recognize that they have a great zeal for God. But sadly, it is a zeal without knowledge. Romans 10, verse 2 and verse 3, Paul talks about the Israelites. And he says, I bear them record that they have a zeal for God, but not according to knowledge. For they, being ignorant of God's righteousness and going about to establish their own righteousness, have not submitted themselves unto the righteousness of God. We need to submit ourselves to the righteousness of God and not go off and start practicing and doing those things that are simply the commandments of men and find their origin in man. Amen, and the saying of amen is according to knowledge. The clapping of hands finds its origin in man. Let's make sure we do things according to God's will. That certainly includes, and I realize this lesson isn't designed to necessarily convert one to Christ, but the Bible teaches us how we are to be converted to Christ. That we, upon our faith, repent of our sins. We then make a confession that I believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. And then upon those things, we then can be baptized in water for the forgiveness of our sins. And we can then come into that approved relationship with God, whereby we can worship God acceptably with reverence and godly fear. We then need to live faithful to God, to His commands, to His will, as we record it within the New Testament. And everything that we do, word or deed, find authority from God for our actions. If you haven't been living the type of lifestyle that God wants, or you need to be converted to Christ this evening, we would plead with you to come and do those things that are necessary to have the salvation of your sins and a home with God in heaven in eternity. You need to come and do so as we stand and sing the invitation song.